with you again this Sunday morning, as it is each Sunday morning at this same time, and we do count it a privilege to be able to come into your homes and spend this half hour with you. We hope that you have your Bible as we are taking a survey through the Gospel of John. We are now over to the fifth chapter, and we hope that you will take your Bibles and open them there. And like the other chapters in John, we have here a miracle recorded in John chapter 5, verses 1 to 16, and then we have the message based upon that miracle in the fifth chapter here in verses 17 to 47. So this morning we'll only have time to examine the miracle, and then next week we'll take the message based upon the miracle. Now, this sign completes the three miracles that show how a person is saved if you have been following with us over the past 4 or 5 weeks. The first, of course, was water to wine, shows that salvation is through the Word because Christ just spoke it, and the water turned into wine. The second was a healing of the nobleman's son, shows us that salvation is by faith because he did not even go home that day. Christ spoke it, and his son was healed, and he went home the next day, showing his faith was in the power of the Word of God. And the third miracle here shows that salvation is by grace. You see, this man was in a pitiful condition. Let's read here the first few verses here in John chapter 5. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now, there is a Jerusalem by the sheep market. That should be the sheep gate, a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having 5 porches. And in these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind and halt. Halt means that they were lame or crippled, withered, waiting for the moving of the waters. And for an angel went down at a certain season unto the pool and troubled the waters, and whatsoever then, or whosoever then, first after the troubling of the water stepped in, was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. And there was a certain man that was there that had an infirmity 38 years. Now we're going on down here in verse 14 and find out why he had this infirmity. In verse 14 we find out here, afterward Jesus findeth him in the temple, and saith unto him, Behold, thou art made whole, sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. So the reason he had been afflicted for some 38 years was because of some sin that is not named. The Lord didn't name it, but he did something that caused him an infliction for 38 years. That's a long time, a terrible price to pay for it. Now, as we go back, as we've said before, the man was in a pitiable condition because of the past sin that we've just read in verse 38. He'd been afflicted some 38 years. He was surrounded by afflicted people, all of whom illustrate the sad condition of the unsaved. Now, let me stop just a second and bring out something that I think is interesting to comprehend here concerning many times why some people are sick. If you'll notice, I think this would be a good cross-reference, and we can see what the Lord's saying here. Turn with me, if you will, to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. To 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and we find out over here that there was also some people who were sick. Some of them had even been killed by the Lord because of disgracing the Lord's Supper. Now, we're over here to 1 Corinthians, and we're here in chapter 11. All right, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, let us look here now, if you will, in verse 30, where the Lord says this, 1 Corinthians 11:30. It says, For this cause many of you are weak and sickly among you, and many of you sleep. The cause, if you read on the first part of the chapter here, is the fact they were actually disgracing the Lord's Supper. They were making a mockery out of it, and God's judgment upon them in Corinth was, he said, Paul, write to them and tell these people why they are afflicted, why they are sickly, why they are weak physically, and why some of them have already died, and tell them why. So we find out here that some of these people were sick and afflicted because God did it to them because they had been a disgrace to the Lord. Now, let's go on back and we see something else that's sort of interesting here concerning the sickness here, and we find it back here in the book of James. Back here in the little book of James, and let's notice here in chapter 5, and notice, if you will, in verses 14 and 16. It says here, Is any sick among you, let him call for the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with the oil in the name of the Lord. Now, it used to be the oil was a healing agency, We do not anoint with the oil anymore because that custom is passed off. We have other medicines that we use and not the oil. The oil was used for healing. Something I would like to point out here in verse 14, anoint him with the oil, but then notice in verse 15, and the prayer of the faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up, and if he had committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Implying here that some of them that were afflicted have committed sins. Not all of them, but some of them. Now notice here in verse 16, confess your faults one to another, and pray one for another, that you may be healed. Other words, there were some who have done things to other people, and afflicted other people. And he said, confess your faults one to another, pray one for another, that you may be healed. Other words, no doubt they were lacking in the relationship with some other Christians, some things they had done to them, and God had struck them down also and brought physical ailments to them. So he says, confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that you may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And a righteous man whose one is righteous enough to confess his faults one to another. If I've wronged somebody, then go tell them and apologize to it. But the point we're making is simply this, that in some cases, Christ has brought physical ailments on people because of the sins in their life. Now, this is what happened to the impotent man back here in John chapter 5. Now, again, we say that he was surrounded by afflicted people, all of whom illustrate the sad condition of the unsaved. Impotent means without power, and we might reference that to Romans chapter 5, verse 6. Romans chapter 5, verse 6. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto you. And then in verse 6, for when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. We were without strength. And then we also find out, blind and halt means that we are unable to walk correctly, unable to walk correctly. And we find in the book of Ephesians that it gives us exactly that. Notice in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 to 3. And you who hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in times past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, and the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. So this lost man here pictures, the man that is withered here, pictures the lost sinner who cannot walk at all, cannot walk correctly. Withered means paralysis and waiting without hope. In Ephesians 2:12, it says, and at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenants of the promise, having no hope and without God in the world. I don't know of a sadder condition than a lost person. I know many times they don't think about dying, but they have no hope, absolutely no hope. It seems like I've seen people that have worked for years to get things, get everything set, and all of a sudden some tragedy happened and they lose everything almost overnight, or within a year, or within 2 years, and work their fool head off to get everything set, everything ahead, do anything they can to get financially secure in this world, and then it seems like overnight they lose it all. Either death comes into the family, either they're stricken with cancer, or stricken with some sort of sickness of some kind, and everything they work for just goes right down the drain. And it seems like that happens sometimes. Now, not all the time, but sometimes. And you wonder, you know, they're withered. They're without hope. And when it comes to the end, here all their hopes are built upon their own achievements, their own accomplishments, everything, their own education, everything they can do, and then it's wiped out overnight, without hope. I'm so glad of this. When it comes time, and I don't know anybody that can leave this world without dying, of course, unless the rapture comes, but then you got to be saved to go with the rapture. But then, when it comes to leaving this world, there isn't anything that matters like knowing the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you've been with people, when they've died, some of them that are lost and see actually the look in their eyes and the scaredness, and actually sometimes the screams that come out just seconds before they die. And then you're with other people who say and tell you, Pastor, I'm ready to meet the Lord. What a peace they have. What a contrast. One is without hope, and the other is with hope. I hope you know the Lord Jesus Christ. I hope you have that hope of knowing where you're going to spend eternity. Now, as we go on, we find out this. Even if these people could get into the water when the angel came, they could be healed. But they lacked the power to get there. And it's like the sinner today. If he could keep God's perfect law, he could be saved, but he's unable to do so. In James chapter 2, verse 10, we find out that the Lord said, "Whosoever shall keep the whole law, yet offend in just one point, then they're guilty of all." And you know, so many times we talk to people, and honestly, truthfully, they try to do the very best they can. But I don't know how many people that I've talked to and asked them, "Do you know where you're going to go when you die?" And they'll say, "Well, I hope I'm going to heaven. I'm trying the best I can." And yes, they are good people. They are righteous people. They are moral people. And the men provide for their families, and they do have a good home, but they don't have Christ. And one of the things I always ask them is this: well, are you perfect? Are you as perfect as God? Well, of course, I've never had anyone say they were yet. But nevertheless, when you point that out to them, we must be as righteous as God to have eternal life. That's the reason God hath made him, that's Christ, to be sin for us who knew no sin, that I might be made the righteousness of God in him. And God gives me the righteousness of Jesus Christ when I put my faith in him, and he takes all the filth of my sin and pays the penalty and marks it paid at the cross of Calvary. And when I put my faith in Christ, I simply have an exchange. God gives me the righteousness of Jesus Christ, clothes me in the white robe of righteousness, takes the filth, the sin, and marks it paid 2,000 years ago on the cross of Christ. And I'm found in him not having my own righteousness, which is not as righteous as God, because I fall short of the glory of God, but the righteousness which is by faith in Jesus Christ. And Philippians chapter 3, verse 9 bears out the same thing. But then we go on and we find out. We see the grace of God at work. Bethsaida means the house of grace, and this is what it became for one man. What does grace mean? It means kindness to those who are undeserving. Grace is contrasted with mercy. Grace means God giving us what we do not deserve. And mercy means God withholding what we do deserve. Grace is giving us eternal life, which we do not deserve, and mercy is withholding judgment that we do deserve. So many people cry out, "Give me my just reward." Well, that would be hell, because you've sinned and come short of the glory of God. But then we find out here, Jesus saw a multitude of sick people, but he chose one man and he healed him. And this man was no more deserving than the others, but God chose him. This is a beautiful picture of salvation, and how it ought to humble us to know that we are chosen in him, not because of our own merits. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4. Not of our own merits. What Christ says in chapter 5, verse 21 applies here, and let's read it, if you will. "For as the Father raiseth up the dead and quickeneth them, even so the Son quickeneth whom he will." He quickens, or he gives life, to whom he will. And of course, this is speaking of those who put their faith in Jesus Christ. And without the grace of God, nobody is ever saved. Now, there are some other points as we just scant through here and look at this miracle that was given. We find out there were five porches, and five in the Bible, of course, most of you Bible students knows the number of grace. When Christ was crucified, there were five holes in his body, two in his hands, two in his feet, one in his side. Five is the number of grace all the way through the Bible. Five porches showing the number of grace, and the pool was by the sheep's gate, which speaks of sacrifice. And the Lamb of God had to die before God's grace could be poured out upon the sinner. Christ healed him on the Sabbath. And this proved that the law had nothing to do with it. We are not saved by keeping the law. You see, he healed the man by himself, for salvation is of Christ alone. And I think this is one of the biggest things that men and church and preachers and other people try to do to God's grace. They try to include baptism as a part of salvation. They try to include good works as a condition for salvation. They try to include church membership as a condition for salvation instead of little realizing there is no salvation in any of these human merits whatsoever. No matter how religious they look, no matter how wonderful they appear to people, there is no salvation in anyone except the person, the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember this, you joining a church, the church didn't pay for your sins. You being water baptized, that water up there didn't pay for your sins. you, being a good righteous person, did not pay the penalty of God for the sin you did commit. You see, Jesus Christ paid that penalty. He's the only one. Salvation is in a person, not a church, not a body of water, not good intentions. And even though you're doing the very best you could do, remember this, to go to heaven, you must be as righteous as God. And again, the Lord says in 2 Corinthians 5:21, He hath made him Christ to be sin for us, who knew no sin. See, he knew no sin, so he could pay for our sin. And the only way you can go to heaven is if you have never sinned in your life. Then you would be as righteous as Christ, because Christ would not be eligible to pay for your sin if he had ever sinned himself. Therefore, God said, He hath sent him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. So it takes a sinless person to pay for the sins of a sinner, and if there's any human being that was ever sinless, then he would not need a sin bearer, which is Christ. Then Christ died in vain. And if there's any one person who could ever be sinless, then that means you and I could be sinless. And God has concluded that there's no one sinless, not even Mary, not even Joseph, no one except Christ. We have all sinned to come short of the glory of God. Now, let us go on down, if you will. Again, we've said here, the man complained, I have no man. Notice in verse 7 here, if you will, in chapter 5, verse 7. He says, the impotent answered and said, Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. He said, I have no man. But had a dozen men been there to help him, they could not have done what Jesus did. You see, the lost sinner does not need help. He needs healing. Not only was Christ this man's Savior, we see something else. He was also his Lord. We find out, for he obeyed his word in spite of opposition. Christ not only wants to save us, but he also wants to direct our lives. You see, the man went out to the temple for worship in the house of God, we see, is one sure evidence of salvation. He publicly witnessed for Christ and told them that Christ had healed him. Notice in verse 15, if you will. The man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus that had made him whole. Sad to say, there are some Christians, because of the influence of your family, you're afraid to mention Christ. You're afraid of your position at work. You're going to get fired, or you're going to have your mother-in-law or your father-in-law down your neck, because, after all, they've been raised in this church, and now you're saved, but you're not going to mention Christ because you don't want to cause any waves in the family. How sad it is. You know one thing? Christ wasn't ashamed of you, and he doesn't want you to be ashamed of him. And somewhere down the line, you're going to have to confess the Lord Jesus Christ and stand on what you know to be the truth, even to your own family. That's the reason the Lord said in Matthew, he said, I've come to send a variance between the father and the son, and the mother-in-law and the son-in-law and the daughter-in-law. The reason is, Christ is a divider. It's not God's will a family be divided, but knowing that if you take a stand for Christ, not everybody is going to just pat you on the back, because they may be religious but lost. Who knows? Your testimony may be an influence upon that family, but you haven't got enough backbone yet to stand up for what you know to be true and the Christ who died for you. You haven't reached that point yet where you're not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, the power of God unto salvation of everyone that believeth. Praise God for the man and the woman who will witness to their family. This man went to the Jews in spite of the opposition. You might reference 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 11 to 14. For don't be ashamed of the fiery trial which shall try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you. Well, we see all this in the impotent man here, and we find out this. This was only the beginning of the hatred and opposition to Christ. This conflict grows worse from chapter 7 to 12 and finally leads to the crucifixion of Christ. Praise God for those who are not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, the power of God to salvation to everyone that believeth. You and I have been just like this impotent man, lame, blind, halt, withered, without hope. But now he found Christ, and Christ healed you spiritually. You're a new person or a new creation in Jesus Christ. Let's tell people about him. I hope you'll be that kind of Christian. Well, I see our time's gone, and it's been so good to be with you again this Sunday morning. We pray that you'll take just a minute and sit down and drop us a line, write us, let us know that you're listening. And again, if God lays it upon your heart to help us financially, we can surely use that. Until next week, may the truth of God's Word keep marching on.